Hello and welcome to The Punchline. I'm your comic strip critic. Does anybody else here remember a little show called Dexter's Laboratory? In case you were too old to know the show, or too young and missed it, boy, isn't that a scary thought. Dexter's Lab was an animated show that ran on Cartoon Network in the mid-1990s to the early 2000s. The show focused on a boy genius and many of his madcap adventures that unfolded due to his massive underground laboratory. It was a great show that led to what I personally remember as the golden age of Cartoon Network. Dexter's Lab, The Powerpuff Girls, Samurai Jack, The Grim Adventures of Billy and Mandy, lots of good stuff. But why am I bringing up a TV show that ended its run over a decade ago? Because I'm almost certain that John Hambrock had Dexter in mind when he was creating his comic strip. Dexter's spiritual successor can be found in the brilliant mind of Edison Lee. Syndicated by King Features and first appearing in newspapers in late 2006, Edison Lee is a 10-year-old boy in love with science and inventing. Obviously named for Thomas Edison, the boy lives with his father Don, his mother Carol, and his grandfather Orville. On the more sciencey side of things, Edison's sole companion is his lab rat Jules, who can walk and talk like any human being. Sadly, however, Jules' entire understanding of life outside the lab comes from Edison, and Edison's portrayal of that world can be a bit, shall we say, eccentric? There are a few basic rules to follow when playing chess, Jules. For instance, you're white, so I get to go first. Look at that! My rook got your queen. It means I get another turn, and my king gets a power shield for the next 5 moves. Now my pawn is going to fly over and take your bishop. Pawns can fly? Only if the queen orders them to, and since yours was captured, your pawns are stuck where they are, living out their lives as blithering idiots. Well, how do I get my queen back? You have to pay me $10. Hey, wait, we haven't even gotten to the Vortex of Doom part of the game yet. And then they signed up with the local Calvin Ball League and lost to that guy with his tiger. Never mess with the champ, baby! 10 years running, you and me! You can't stop me now! So the artwork in Edison Lee is really nice. In terms of style, I'm reminded quite a fair bit of Calvin and Hobbes, Peanuts, or Nancy when reading this. Big head, small body, lots of detail and depth on display. And there's a great variety of color, too. Most of the time, Edison is a gag-a-day comic, bouncing back and forth between Edison and Jules, Edison and his parents, Edison and his grandpa, and Edison and his senator. Yes, his senator. See, in addition to the various madcap hijinks, Edison Lee is also a little bit of a satirical strip, and Senator Ottoman, whose party has never been identified, is always the target of such satire. Senator Ottoman accused of accepting bribes. Oh, that's a politically motivated accusation. Company CEO admits giving bribes to the senator for lucrative government contracts. Sheer innuendo. Emails from the senator himself prove he took the bribes. Flimsy evidence at best. Senator admits wrongdoing. Look, is there a point to this article? As far as I can tell, Senator Ottoman is not meant to demonize one particular political party or political figure. He's just a way to make fun of American politics in general, without having anybody get insulted too much either way. And it makes sense, because Edison Lee is not primarily an editorial comic, it's still, at its heart, a character-driven comedy strip. My favorite character aside from Edison is probably his grandpa Orville. Orville, who I presume is named for one of the famous Wright brothers, is a lazy, gluttonous man in love with fast food and the TV. Everyone on the staff of the local Jolly Burger fast food joint apparently recognizes him on sight, usually for things like this. I'd like a chocolate milkshake. No dessert until you eat your vegetables. But you don't serve vegetables. Are you getting smart with me, young man? No, I would never dream of putting you and smart in the same sentence. Oops. Where's your grandfather?
In timeout.
It's that tiny little oops that really sells the comic. That moment of dawning self-realization. That moment when you realize just how hard you stuck your foot in your mouth. Orville is quite prone to these moments. Shut up, no I wasn't. It's also worth mentioning that Edison Lee does run the occasional storyline. There have only been two so far in 2014, but they're both very, very long, each of them running for well over a month and a half. Wow. Edison apparently has a small science rivalry with Katie, another girl in his class who I'm sure he has no subliminal crush on whatsoever. Hey, wait, I think I've heard this one before. He's all set to show her up with some fantastic new invention at the science fair when the fair is suddenly canceled. Hee-hee, I get it. This is just a big April Fool's joke. The principal announced the cancellation. That silly man, always kidding around. They're taking down the poster. Ah, part of the ruse, I assure you. You guys are too funny, really. Let it go.
Let it go?
No. No, I don't. It doesn't matter. The joke's been done a million times by now, and it's just old. Oh, come on, don't do it! You son of a... Anyways, Edison finds out that the fair was canceled because the budget was slashed to make room for athletic cups for the soccer team. Yeah, okay, they kind of need those, but that's not going to stop our young hero. So our young scientist goes to the soccer coach and actually blackmails him with itching pouch so that they can work out an agreement. The coach agrees to give back the money to the science fair if the math teacher agrees to tutor a key player so he can pass his next test and still play soccer. But the math teacher won't help unless Edison sets him up on a date with the librarian. And the math teacher thinks that she's still a little young for him. She's 92. It's been a while since I've gotten out the brain bleach. The librarian won't give the math teacher a date unless the principal gives her time off to practice for her American Idol auditions, but the principal won't give her time off unless Edison gets the head of the PTA off his back because she's a pain in his butt. The head of the PTA promises to ease up if only good, clean, wholesome music is played at the upcoming school dance, like Raffy or Bunny the Dinosaur. But Raffy won't come and perform at the school dance unless you can drive out the magical Wiz from his house. The Wiz, however, wants the secret notebook of Charles Schulz's lost comics for their archive collection.
So you find the notebook, give it to the Wiz, who tell you the reach of the Time Lord, you have to drop your Orb of the Moons one step to the northwest, but you don't have an Orb of the Moon, so you have to talk to Lord Bridges and get you a spare! That was one quest!
I know! And the sad part is, all it takes is one kid to switch on iPods so that Can't Touch This starts playing, and the whole thing is off. No easing up, no vacation, no date, no tutoring, no science for money, no MIT scholarship. Wait, what? Why? I failed to get back our science fair money! I failed! Go ahead, Katie, rub it in. FYI, my father offered to sponsor this year's fair. He did? Yep, right after it was canceled. And you didn't tell me? What? I miss out on watching you try to get the money your way? So Katie has saved the science fair. Edison decides to enter a cybernetic senator into the contest. Katie enters an everlasting battery. Some other kid who we've never met before wins, and finally, the storyline comes to an end. So that's the brilliant mind of Edison Lee. Does it live up to its claim of brilliance? Very close, and it's still a very, very good strip, but it's not quite brilliant. Don't get me wrong, I did enjoy Edison very, very much, and I think that overall John Hambrock has created a very well-made comic. Heck, I've even added it to my personal Comics Kingdom page. But there are a few issues that keep me from really being absorbed into his work. The storylines feel a bit too stretched out, which makes them feel a bit exhausting to read. I actually skipped over summarizing a full week and a half of Edison talking to Katie and Senator Ottoman because it didn't really add anything. And the science fair itself just wasn't as interesting as the series of fetch quests that led up to it. It's not that they're too long. The stories in, say, The Amazing Spider-Man or Dick Tracy are just as long, if not longer. Edison just lacks a certain intangible quality that comics like Retail and Luann have. I've accidentally stayed up all night reading those, but I can't see myself doing it with Edison. Despite my few nitpicks, however, I did enjoy reading The Brilliant Mind of Edison Lee, and I recommend you go check it out. It's a young comic that's in need of some serious lovin', so who knows? Maybe if you read it, you'll find it more absorbing than I did. Until next time, I'm your comic strip critic, and I read the funny pages in search of brilliant minds.